Hello students, we are in the second chapter of your geography textbook and the chapter's name is Forest and Wildlife Resources. Now, if you have noticed in the index of your textbook, it's talking about different kind of resources. And this year, your syllabus is only about resources and it's important for you to know because it's preparing you for the higher classes, 11th and 12th, well, where you'll be studying the resources in more depth. Now, this chapter is about the forest and wildlife resources, and the reason for learning this chapter is, of course, for your examinations, but just don't learn it just for the sake of examination. First, you try to learn about it, why actually this is important. When you learn for examinations, you will get marks. But when you learn for knowing a topic, then you get a permanent result from that. The topics that we are going to cover here are about the flora and fauna in India, then classification of species as per IUCN. IUCN stands for International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. Then we are going to see some definitions, then causes of depletion of forest and wildlife in India, conservation of forest and wildlife in India. Then we are looking at some success stories such as Project Tiger. Then types of forests and distribution of wildlife resources in India. And we are going to see the role of community in the conservation of wildlife and resources. Now, when we look at this term known as biodiversity, biodiversity means the varieties in life forms. We have some organisms which are very small, microscopic, and some limited to certain kind of habitats. Then there are some which are present in almost every kind of habitat. There are some which are very big, very populous, some are very rare, some are genetically different, some are different only in the appearance, and so on and so forth. We have a wide variety of life on Earth, and this variety of life is in simple terms known as biodiversity. You know about the different human races already. And you're observant of this, and you and I all belong to a certain race. Similarly, in the wild also, you have different species, you have different genetic makeup, you have different structural and appearance makeup. Now, these two are both are panthers, but one is a black panther that is known as that's a condition known as melanism. Similarly, you have seen white tigers also. That is a case of albinism. Now, when I was in a college, we had a topic like this known as biodiversity, and we were given a small practical to do. In that, we took drawing pins and some length of thread, went to the college ground, and we divided, we selected one area, and we marked that with the thread and the pins into small squares, and we counted the number of grasses varieties there, and we counted the number of grasses and the types of grasses, and I was surprised that something so common as a grass can have such a lot of variety. The same thing you can do in your house also. If you take a common animal such as a house fly, just see, you have flies which are very tiny. They are known as fruit flies. Then there are flies which are the usual ones. Then you have a fly with circular wings and medium-sized bodies. Then you have flies with a metallic shine, metallic blue shine. and so on and so forth. You already have diversity surrounding you, and this diversity surrounding you of living things is an example of biodiversity around you. Now, all these animals and plants and microorganisms, they survive in a certain type of surrounding, that surrounding in which they get their food, in which they can reproduce, in which they get safety, and they can perform their life activities. That is known as habitat. Now, here's an habitat we are common with. This is a city, and this is Mumbai, and you can see the Queen's Necklace in the distance. This is our habitat, that is their habitat. Our habitat is like this. This is Churchgate railway station with Borivali local just about to start. In India, we have a variety of plants and animals. The term flora, you know, represents all the types of plants, big or small. Fauna are all the types of animals included together. More than 81,000 species of plants are there in India. And more than 47,000 species of, more than 81,000 species of animals including right from an insect up to something as big as a blue whale. More than 47,000 species of plants, more than 15,000 species of plants, flowering plants are endemic to India. That means they're indigenous or they are not found anywhere else in the world apart from our country. Then forest and tree cover is 79.42 million hectares, and that amounts to 24% of India's land area. The government aims at 33% at least, but that we are not able to achieve. Then dense forest cover has increased by 3,775 square kilometer, and this is mainly due to conservation measures. Now, out of this, at least 10% of the wild flora is threatened by extinction. At least 20% of the animals are on the threatened list also. I mentioned about IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. They classify species into various classes. They call the normal species, endangered species, vulnerable species, rare species, endemic species, or extinct species. Now, 20% of our animals are on the threatened list, and 10% of the plants are on the threatened list as well. Some animals and plants have gone forever. The cheetah from India has gone forever. The pink-headed duck, mountain quail, forest spotted owlet, trees such as Manduka insignis. This is a type of mahua tree. This is gone. Habardia heptaneuron is a type of grass. This also has gone forever. The rate of extinction happens in the natural state also, but that is a slow state rate. But the rate of extinction because of human activity is 50 times or 100 times more than the natural rate. Now, you're familiar with this structure. It's a leaf, a dicot leaf. And it is because of the chlorophyll that it is green in color. And it is because of the chlorophyll and the stomata present on these leaves and the soil this plant is fixed to and the atmosphere which makes it conducive, provides it with carbon dioxide and the sunlight it harvests as the only source of energy known to all living things. So this leaf is a biological energy cell. And it gathers the sun's energy and converts it into carbohydrates and makes that carbohydrate available to herbivores first and from there to carnivores. This you have studied in the previous classes also. And that is how the living organisms on earth get their source of energy, without which no life on earth could survive. Now we are going to see some classifications of IUCN. One is the normal species. These are the species whose population levels are considered to be normal for their survival. Examples can be cattle, it can be all the dogs, it can be the rodents. One of the rodents is black named hare, but you can take any other species which is abundant. That is a normal species. Endangered species are the ones which are in the danger of extinction. If they are not conserved now, they will be gone forever. And Indian rhino is one example. You also have black buck, the crocodile, the lion-tailed macaque, the sangai, the Indian wild ass, and so on. Many are there. Vulnerable species are those whose population has declined to levels from where it is not likely to recover, and it's likely that they will move from there to the endangered category. You have the blue sheep, Asiatic elephant. This is the Gangetic dolphin. These are vulnerable species. Rare species are ones which have reduced in number. The population is very small, and they may move to endangered or vulnerable category if they are not protected. This is a Himalayan brown bear, and this, along with Asiatic wild buffalo, desert fox, and hornbill, all are rare species now. They are not commonly met with. Endemic species are species which are found only in a particular isolated area. This is a Nicobar pigeon, and it is found only in the Nicobar Islands. This is a type of wild cattle now domesticated, and this is known as Mithun. Not from Bollywood or from Tollywood, but it is from the forest of the northeast. And you have to remember one thing. The reason why I require biodiversity is because the genes from the wild species, they strengthen the genes of our domestic species. That is known as hybridization. And because of that, the benefit we have is that our livestock are sturdy. They are more disease resistant. They produce more good quality of milk, for example. It is true also for plants. If we have wild gene coming into our agricultural plants, our agricultural plants become more disease resistant. They produce more yield. So this is the advantage of having the wild gene mixing with our common and domestic gene. Extinct species are the species which are not found in an area. Now this an area can be anything. It can be one locality, or it can be one state, or it can be one country, or it can be the world as well. This bird on the left hand side, this is the pink headed duck. This used to be common in the northern India once upon a time. And in the 1870s, the Calcutta bird market used to see 10-12 birds every week. But it so happened that from 1935 onwards, there were no sightings, no trappings. The last bird was seen in Darbhanga district in Bihar. And after that, this has been declared as extinct. It's gone forever. This animal is the cheetah. It is different from a leopard. The cheetahs have this line, black line, like tears running from the eyes, down from the eyes. And the spots, they're different. Leopards have spots appearing like roses, black roses. three male leopards were shot in 1948 in a area called Korea in Bastar district. That time it was Madhya Pradesh, now it is Chhattisgarh. And in 1952, it was officially declared to be extinct. But this animal is there in the African continent. Indian cheetah has gone forever. There's one spelling mistake in your textbook about the scientific name of this animal. It is Acinonyx jubatus and not jubantus. This is another species of bird. This is a mountain quail, and this is also extinct now. This is a freshwater crocodile. It is known as gharial. And you can see that growth on the snout. This is a male, and males have this growth. And this is a harmless reptile, feeding mainly on fishes and small animals it can take. And this is also on the endangered list. Endangered also is the black buck. Although government is trying its best to protect it, but it has got competition from the feral or the unkept common logs of all things. And even in the protected areas, this unwanted dogs are there, and they must be harming these animals and also others, and this goes unchecked in India. Even animals such as insects are also endangered. This is also endangered, and this butterfly is known as the Bhutan glory. The reason for it being endangered is people collect and people pay a lot of money for preserved specimen of this butterfly. There are several others insects, some dragonflies also, which have been included in the endangered list. This plant is known as Himalayan yew, and this produces one chemical known as Taxol. And this Taxol is being used for treating cancer, and this plant is also endangered. Vulnerable species, even though we find them in our towns, people, Mahavats bring elephants, and we have elephants in our temple towns also. But if a poacher were to see a tusker like this, with such beautiful tusks, they will target the individual and not rest till it gets killed and the tusk is in their bags. Having elephants in the temples doesn't mean anything. They are still vulnerable species. This is Kashmir stag or hangul. This is the only variety of elk deer in India. The government has declared an area in Kashmir known as Dachigam for the protection of this animal. And this also is vulnerable. There are other species also vulnerable, such as the snow leopard. This is the great Indian bustard. It's a heavy bird, good flyer, but much sought after for its flesh. This is also endangered. It's known as Godavan in Hindi. And Karera is a place in MP where there's a sanctuary for these birds. There are many other birds which are endangered also. Everything is not so grim. This is a bird which has made a comeback. The Jerdon's cruiser or double banded cruiser was once thought to be extinct, but now there are sightings in Andhra Pradesh in the Kadapa district.
And this bird has made a comeback.
The causes of depletion of forest and wildlife. If you see the history, it's about the development. Whenever development takes place, we have to sacrifice something. And unfortunately, it's the wildlife and the resources, the forest resources, which we felt are not so important. And they have been done away with. One may argue that what else could we have done? But look at European countries such as Germany. It's a developed country, we know. But look at their wildlife. It is still intact. This is the time from the British period, colonial period, when railways was being laid down, and they have contributed immensely to the development of a country by having the railways in a country. But at the cost of this, we have lost our forests. Mining causes a lot of damage to forest and wildlife. It damages the land. It damages the tree cover on that land. It damages the animals of that land. It disturbs the sound of the blasting and of the machinery. It disturbs and sends away all the wildlife from there. Then continuity of forest is broken. This is Baksa Tiger Reserve in West Bengal. And it's a place for dolomite mining. And because of the mining, the elephants, they don't have a corridor to move. And then they come in conflict with the people. And the elephants lose. This is an area not in the core area of mining, but you can see the damage done by human activity. This is just the tip of the iceberg. But we still require development. Only thing, if it is sustainable, good, otherwise we are losing. Now, agriculture also causes deforestation. It is clear in this photograph. If you see, one side there is agricultural field and the other side there is forest. So we clear the forest for our agriculture. We need agriculture because we have to feed our population. And unfortunately, we often do that at the expense of our forest and wildlife. Now, there's something known as shifting cultivation or zoom cultivation. This is also known as slash and burn cultivation. In this, what is done is, forest area is selected, a relatively plain land with forest cover, and it is the plants are hewn down and the area is burnt. The worst part than this itself is that after a few times cultivation, maybe 3-4 times or 10 times, the farmer moves to another place and repeats this massacre once again. So this is again one important cause of depletion of forests. Illegal poaching, hunting and felling of trees is another reason. This poor elephant has got only a few seconds to live. The result of poaching, lot of poaching goes unnoticed, but often the poachers are caught and their horrible goods confiscated. And here you can see the skins of tigers. Some of them are quite large, and leopards and other wildlife. I have counted 29 tiger skins here. It's such a pity that we kill our animals like this. Illegal felling of trees is also a crime, just like killing animals. And you can see some trees cut, or we can say that some trees have been killed and nobody did anything about it. There are large-scale developmental projects in India. The Narmada Valley project is one such project, and it resulted in the submergence of 40,000 hectares of land in Madhya Pradesh. Now this project was required because it gives water to Gujarat also. But at what cost? Similar one is Tihri project in Gadwal. And that place is unstable because of the tectonic activity. And here these people are protesting. They are standing in water till their neck, because soon afterwards their houses will be submerged. They do not care for summer or winter, they just protest. But our government has its way finally, and the project was built, and these people lost their land. Now in the first 3 decades of our independence, we have lost 26,200 square kilometer of forest to such activities, to agriculture and developmental activities. That's a big amount of land. It's almost as big as a small state of India. And to get the real picture of what the situation today is, imagine a cup of hot tea in which you put a cube of ice, and the rate at which the ice is going to disappear is the rate at which our wildlife and forest is disappearing. Overgrazing, because we don't have a systematic way of animal husbandry. We don't keep our animals in cattle sheds and feed them. We just leave them out like this, and here they do their maximum to damage the environment. Now the conservation measures taken by the government is the establishment of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act in 1972. Then protecting habitats, listing down the endangered species, banning hunting and poaching, restricting wildlife trade, establishing national parks and wildlife sanctuaries, involving communities in conservation, protecting specific animals, focusing on conservation of biodiversity. Now, Project Tiger is one successful project taken up by the government. And there are animals in the habitat of this animal, tiger, which have also benefited indirectly because they live in the same habitat. I want to tell you one thing. If you notice the pattern of the black and yellow lines on this animal's forehead, in China, that pattern is known as Wang, and Wang is also the name, word for king. So they consider this animal to be the king, and they have temples dedicated for the tigers. But at the same time, they destroy this animal. They use everything from its whiskers to its tail, to its bone, to its teeth, to its claws, everything, to the skin, everything they use for preparing medicines, which do not work, of course. But they have soup out of everything, and this animal is endangered in India, because not because we Indians eat their soup, but it's sold outside. And unfortunately, even in these countries, you can find anything from wildlife available on their e-commerce sites. That's really unfortunate. In India, we have Nilgai, and just because the name Gai comes there, we do not harm that animal. We do not harm that animal. Because it's linked with religious sentiments. But that is not so in their country. They say that they have religious sentiments about this animal, but at the same time they destroy it. Project Tiger started in India in 1973, and today there are 3,346 tigers. There was a time when at the beginning of of the 20th century, there were 55,000 tigers. Now they reduced in number, and then some people realized, no, something wrong is happening, and then this was started. Today there are 39 tiger reserves in India, and some of the well-known reserves are listed here. Of course, there are more. Kanha National Park is a very well-known tiger reserve, and the state of Madhya Pradesh itself has got 75% area under forest cover, and it's known as a tiger state also. They project themselves as tiger state of India, and they say it's the heart of India. And if you read the books written by Jim Corbett, he writes that tiger is really a gentleman at heart. Now that the types of forests in India, we have reserved forest, and this is a category of forest where all human activities are restricted or banned except with special permission. Protected forests are the category of forest where some human activities are allowed, such as grazing, gathering firewood, etc. The unclassed forests are the forest areas and wastelands belonging to both government and private individuals or communities. Now, we see some community activities which has resulted in some results, good results of conservation. CIPCO movement is one of them. They resisted deforestation successfully, and they did afforestation, that is planting of forest species with indigenous species, and they were very successful in that. They practiced traditional cultivation methods and traditional conservation methods, and they have citizens groups such as Beach Bachao Andolan and now Tanya. Beach Bachao Andolan is to protest against the genetically modified seeds and the harm they can have on the other seeds. Now Tanya is an effort to have chemical free farming using the traditional manure and the traditional seeds, traditional methods. Then joint forest management group, this was started originally by Odisha government and very successful, in which the village communities living in the forest area, they are motivated to contribute to conservation, and in return these people also get something. Either they get non-timber forest produce, and they also get share in the timber harvested by successful protection. So it's a win-win situation for both, for the people as well as for the environment. You know what are sacred trees, you know, peepal tree or the banyan tree are held as sacred, just like the cow is an animal which is sacred to the Hindus. Similarly, we have sacred groves. This is from Odisha, and it says that this particular tree is 340 years old, and this is a sacred tree, it says. Because when we consider something as sacred, we do not destroy it. The Bishnois are a community in Rajasthan, and they have their own set of rules of living. Here you can see this old man bottle feeding the deers, as one would do for one's own children. So such efforts, they result in success, because here the people are involved. These people are involved because they know that their efforts will be beneficial for themselves. Apart from this, in your chapter is mentioned about the Alwar district of Rajasthan. There is one sanctuary known as Bhairav Dev Dhakav Son Chudi sanctuary, and the people there, they have their own set of rules, they have their methods of conservation, and they are very successful. So these are some success stories which is really worth appreciation. And this is the end of the chapter. I am not a YouTubist. Let me tell you, I am a teacher in a school. My name is Sam, and I am an environmentalist at my heart. And this chapter is dear to me. And if you like it, and if you feel that it's going to benefit you, then you give it a thumbs up. And wait for my next video. Subscribe to my channel. Bye.